Hello students, so far we have studied the biographical details of Gugi Vaathiyago, his important works and a summary of his essay on the abolition of English department. In this video, we will do an analysis of the essay and conclude it. Here we will also learn about the role of education in perpetuating colonial attitude and Gugi's arguments regarding introduction of African literature to dismantle colonial structures. Gugi Vaathiyago was born in Kenya in the year 1938. He is a multifaceted intellectual. He is a novelist, essayist, dramatist, journalist, editor, and academic. He founded the Gikuyu language journal Muthiri. He is a political activist who fought against Kenyan dictatorship through the power of word, that is, writing. He rejected his Christian faith and English language itself, and started to write only in Kikuyu, his native language, and Swahili. He resumed his Kenyan identity, adopting his fully Kikuyu name, Gugi Vaathiyago, denying his previous colonial name, which was James Gugi. His legendary personality is connected to his imprisonment and his later forced exile due to his opposing to the regime in 1977. He had embarked on an innovative theatrical play, I Will Marry When I Want, in order to encourage the participation of the audience and the demystification of the theatrical alienation. The dictatorship perceived it as an invitation to free your mind, and he was imprisoned. During his exile, he taught in many American universities such as Yale and New York University. At the moment, he teaches English and comparative literature at the University of California in Irvine. Awards and recognition. Gugi was honored with a UCI medal. He received 12 honorary PhDs from universities spread all over the world, and he has been shortlisted for the Nobel Prize. Among his most famous novels dealing with themes such as tolerance, rebellion, and peace, there is The River Between, published in the year 1986. It describes the Mau Mau rebellion and the unhappy relationship between Christians and non-Christians. A Grain of Wheat, published in the year 1967, was essential for his development as an African author. In this work, Gugi explicitly made clear his political view, and after which he converted exclusively to writing in African languages. He bravely encourages awareness on Kenyan political situation in memoirs such as Detained, A Writer's Prison Diary, or Dreams in a Time of War, a childhood memoir, published in the year 2010. His essays, on the other hand, passionately express his attachment to his land and language, with the aim of spreading consciousness. Remarkable are Homecoming, published in the year 1972, Decolonizing the Mind, The Politics of Language in African Literature, published in the year 1986, claiming the vital importance of African languages in literature, Something Tone and New, An African Renaissance, published in the year 2009. In discussing the long-term effects of colonization, it is imperative to analyze the colonial structures and institutions that remain in place after countries gain their independence, since these structures influence the socialization of generations of people who were not present during the actual period of colonization. Institutions have the power to shape the attitude and behavior of the people who operate within their dominion, as they prescribe norms and tenets of conduct. A crucial example of the staying power of colonial influence is in education. Gogi means to say that education perpetuates colonial influence. Formerly colonized countries in Africa have struggled with the foreign establishment of educational curriculum that governs the development of their students. Education is a means by which a society learns of itself and thus of others. It creates a knowledge of culture, tradition, identity, and provides a basis upon which to negotiate other cultures to accept or reject or integrate their ideas. Therefore, education must act as an extension of the culture of those it wishes to inform. Now, the question arises in post-colonial context. How can education be re-centered? Because the colonial educational system emphasized on European ideology, tradition, and history. They obstruct and undermine the transmission of African cultures, as students were forced to adopt a European perspective of the world and their role in it. As newly emerging nations have dismantled colonial institutions, the issue of education has necessarily received much attention. An important contributor to the theory of post-coloniality is Gogi Watiago, the Kenyan author whose anti-imperialist writings have aided in foregrounding the dilemmas faced by post-colonial countries. He argues for the necessity of the realignment of educational institutions so as to eliminate internally enforced subordination of African culture by the imposition of European frameworks. In the year 1972, Gogi published On the Abolition of English Department. Gogi offered a choice between literary study centered on perpetuating the myths of the empire and one that reconceptualized from the place where readers are located and working outward toward the world and backward through history from there. In 1972, 9 years after Kenya declared its independence from England, Gogi published a paper forwarding the restructuring of the department of the University of Nairobi. In the essay On the Abolition of the English Department, Gogi argues simultaneously for replacing traditional English department with a department of African literature and languages. This change would undermine the basic assumption that the English tradition and the emergence of the modern West is the central root of our consciousness and cultural heritage. Africa becomes an extension of the West. This is the assumption against which Gugge argues in his essay. To place Africa in the center requires a curriculum that teaches from an African perspective, in which African literature is an essential component. Literature describes culture. Thus, the primary duty of any literature department is to eliminate the spirit animating a people, to show how it meets new challenges, and to investigate possible areas of development and involvement. Gugge emphasizes that Africans should use their own literature both to understand their culture and to create continuity with their past. This also appears in the writings of other post-colonial authors. Literature is essential in creating a truly historical consciousness. The articulation of history can empower the present, and strength can be found in the midst of the past. In the beginning of the essay, Gugge gives a vivid picture of the English department in England. English department arose in the late 20th century. Before that, the dominant language was Greek and Latin, mainly focusing on elements of rhetoric and philology. English arose as a discipline to foster an appreciation of culture in the less educated classes who were not trained in Greek and Latin. English was also enmeshed and designed to instill national pride, therefore more of language than literature. The teaching of English language and literature in the departments was also a prominent part of the administration of the British Empire in its many colonies around the globe. Gugge confronted the leaders of the University of Nairobi for its bias or preference for the English language and literature texts in the Department of English, which he signaled a total lack of interest in African literature. They questioned the value of English department in an African context. In the year 1968, Gugge and his colleagues Henry Orr Anyumba and Thaban Yo Leong co-authored a letter titled On the Abolition of English Department. The abolition of the English department to a Department of African Literature and Language is not merely a change of name. This paper highlights that they want to establish the centrality of Africa in the department. This is just logical in a sense that being free from the colonizer means that a country is free to rebuild what was lost during colonization process and placing the real African into the center. It would make the younger generation after colonization to think like Africans and for them to experience and know more about their roots. The English department is a crucial example of the staying power of colonial influence that governs the department, the development of their students. This influence on education is a hindrance to claiming the independence of a country, as it will always redirect the students to imbibing the culture, tradition, and consciousness of their colonizers even after the colonization period comes to an end. It limits the students' chance of knowing their roots. Thus, it will only produce young students who are knowledgeable about their colonizers but ignorant about their roots. The abolition of English department also opens an avenue to place traditional arts and literature of Africa into the curriculum, since they are promoting the Africanism within Africa. It must look back into the pre-colonial literary text, the traditional arts. The traditional oral art is a living tradition that at the present time, there are songs being sung in political rallies, churches. The good thing about including traditional arts is the interlinking of multidisciplinary outlook in studying this form of literature, as it will not only concentrate on literature but also on music, linguistics, sociology, anthropology, history, psychology, religion, and philosophy. Moreover, familiarity of oral literature can offer new techniques and strategies and could foster attitudes of mind characterized by willingness to experiment with new forms. However, they deny that the inclusion of our oral literature in modern African literature will not replace the subject. Rather, it will be a supplement of the subject. The modern African literature is self-evidently centered on everything African. Thus, they considered the following as the scope of their subject. First, the novel written in French and English. Second, African poetry written in French and English with relevant translation of works written by Africans in Portuguese and Spanish. Third, the Caribbean novel and poetry. The scope intensifies the need to place Africa at the heart of the study. I think this is to empower the youth knowledge on how great their culture is compared to the culture imposed by colonizers. Lastly, the abolition of English department and establishment of the Department of African Literature and Languages offers an interlinking between Department of African Literature and Languages and other departments to concentrate on aspects of African thought, not only in literature and languages, but to the owning of Africa and Africans as a whole. However, Gogi's ideas of abolishing English language will not work in the same manner in other colonized countries. I quote, "These rejections of English have by no means proven popular, as the vast body of post-colonial literature in English testifies. In tackling the issue of English, we must never forget to take into account the specific linguistic condition of different locations. In the Caribbean, for example, English cannot be so easily censured. Along with other European languages such as Dutch or Spanish, English became one of the dominant languages in the region during colonial period. Indigenous languages perished with the indigenous people, while the language of African slaves shipped across the Atlantic to work on the plantations were discouraged by colonial authorities. Today, English remains one of the predominant languages of education and power. Consequently, it is more widely spoken among the population than English in India and is less easy to reject. In contrast to the situation Gugi describes in Kenya, it is also difficult to recover an indigenous language in the Caribbean to which one belongs when the native languages have been destroyed, and most frequently spoken languages were brought from overseas, from Europe, Africa, and India, unquote. Thank you.